If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump.
this one's sponsored you by OG Kush.
No, it's not. So for the first, 30 minutes or so, we do our normal introductory conversation, current events talk.
Yeah. It wasn't normal. It was extraordinary.
We talk about the Google heart disease predictive algorithm.
Magic.
They actually have a device or something that can predict heart disease with something like 70% accuracy just by looking into your eyes.
Look into my eyes.
We also talk about the woman who can smell Parkinson's disease. She can actually sniff Parkinson's on someone. And no, it's not when the symptoms are present, Adam. That would be obvious.
Yeah.
We also talk about dogs that can smell cancer. That's actually a true thing. And I think it's bladder cancer.
What does it smell like it?
Huh?
What do you think it smells like?
I have no idea. Yeah. Like cancer.
Okay.
Then we talk about Barney. For those of you that are not old like we are, Barney was this purple dinosaur.
You love me.
It was super, super annoying. Well, the guy that was inside the Barney costume
is now a psychic.
He's a tantric sex guru.
Yeah. Even
tantric
better.
Sex guru. And he did say something about how being Barney helped him with that.
Hmm.
Gross.
Yeah.
We talk about time travelers and psychics.
Oh, that's where the psychics came in.
Time travelers and psychics.
Yeah, so Barney's not a time traveler and a psychic?
Right. No,
but that still would have made sense.
Yeah. I also mentioned Four Sigmatic Chaga and its apparent boner boosting effects.
Whoa.
In fact, it's happening.
I bet you they didn't even know that.
As I'm speaking, we are sponsored by Four Sigmatic. If you go to Four Sigmatic, FourSigmatic.com/mindpump, and enter the code MindPump, you get a discount. And then we did a Thrive Market unboxing. Now, don't forget, Thrive Market is the place online to buy non-GMO organic products, including skin products, hair products, and lots of other things. 2 days shipping. And this company is incredibly low in its prices. In fact, you can buy these products at many times lower costs than their conventional counterparts, which is kind of cool. They also have a drop-down menu now where you can pick keto or paleo or whatever. Doug went keto in this unboxing. Find out what we got from Thrive Market. We are sponsored by them, so it's thrivemarket.com/mindpump. You will get 1 month free membership, $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and completely free shipping. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, how is someone supposed to know whether or not a full body routine is better for them or a body part split is better for them?
It's Betty for me.
We give out the secrets in this episode.
That's totally Betty.
I did good until then.
Yeah.
Then somebody asked us, do we have any advice for someone who wants to start their career as a trainer and then eventually
give awful advice
wants
here.
To open a gym?
dream shattering.
Hey,
you might want to fast forward this one.
Yeah, we suggest you play the lottery.
The person that asked this.
You have better chances there.
Yeah, pretty much.
The next question was, what is our opinion on somebody being motivated to work out just so they can, in their words, get girls? That's kind of creepy sounding. Is extrinsic, I can't say it, motivation as good as intrinsic motivation?
Extrinsic.
You know what I'm talking about.
Well,
when you're motivated by
right
something
now.
Outside of your body versus being motivated by something in your body, Adam.
Yeah. Whoa.
In it.
He gets very motivated when it's intrinsic.
The final question. If you're hungry and you have no other options. So this is one of those either or questions that probably never exist in real life. But let's say this is reality and you only have two options. Eat processed crappy food or don't eat any food. Which one's better? Which
hot dog
one
or
is
no?
Better?
Twinkies though.
Find out in this episode. Also, I've been getting a lot of messages lately from people who are, you know, they're curious. They're like, no joke. A lot of the messages are saying this. Just started listening to Mind Pump. Huge fan. I'm very serious about my fitness. I want to either lose weight, gain weight, whatever. You know, they always tell me their goals. Which program do you think I should do? Now, typically what I do with these people is I ask them what their goals are and I get trying to get deeper. But ultimately, my answer is usually the same. It's either I usually give them two options. One MAPS program that fits their needs. So let's say that they have pain and they want correctional exercise. Well, then I may recommend MAPS Prime or Prime Pro. Or if somebody's like an athlete or functional, you know, exercise practitioner, they really like that kind of training, then I'll say MAPS Performance. Or if they're a bodybuilder, bikini competitor, or they like to train that way, then I'll say MAPS Aesthetic or MAPS Anabolic for people who just want to build, you know, strength and muscle or just kind of getting started out. But the other option I give people is always the same, and that's the Super Bundle. The Super Bundle includes all of those programs, plus it includes MAPS Anywhere. And the Super Bundle is a year of exercise programming. So if you look at your body and you look at how your body responds and reacts to exercise, it responds and reacts to signals that you send it through stresses, through working out. The body quickly adapts to these signals and stops progressing, and that's why you change your adaptation signal. When you have the Super Bundle, it's all planned out for you. So what that means is you can start in MAPS Anabolic, which is 12 weeks. The 12 weeks is broken up into three phases. You do that. You're done with that. Boom. Now you move to another MAPS. Maybe you move to MAPS Performance. Now you're doing MAPS Performance.
And this is going to highlight everything that you may not have been doing, which
everything.
Is beautiful.
Everything. Now you're doing MAPS Performance. That's four phases. That's four, 14 weeks long. Then you're like, you know what? I want to work on my aesthetics. Boom, MAPS Aesthetic. You know what? I want to do some body weight at home type training. Boom, MAPS Anywhere. I mean, you go down the list. Your body's progressing the entire time. It's 1 year of exercise programming. And the best part is here's how we set up our programs. With a lot of other fitness advice, you have to pay monthly every month if you want that. Not with us. You pay once. You get access to these programs for life. For more information, or if you're just serious and you want to do this, go to mindpumpmedia.com.
Did you hear about Google's new algorithm? So Google has this new algorithm that can look at the blood vessels in your eyes and tell what
if you're stoned.
No. Oh. If the potential of having heart disease. And so blood testing right now is like 72% accurate to this, and this test hits at 70%.
It's just imaging the eyes?
Yes, that's all it's doing. You like looking into your computer screen, they can figure this out.
It's all looking to my eyes.
Yeah.
You're going to have a heart attack. Oh, sorry.
Did you already find it, Doug?
Oh, AI algorithm predicts heart disease by looking at your eyes.
Well, what specifically in the eyes are they looking for?
I don't think they tell you.
Well, that sounds like magic.
Bro, it was...
It deduces data.
They ran it on like... they did like a 3,000 study group, right? And 70% of them were spot on accurate, right? Well, the blood testing hits at like 72%. So that's currently right now, that's how we would test for heart disease would be through blood testing. And blood testing is still not 100% accurate. It's 72% accurate. This would hit at 70%. That's a big fucking deal.
And it's non-invasive.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's non-invasive. You could do it probably from your home. That's a big fucking deal.
If it's an
app, that sounds crazy.
Actually, if it's an AI, I could see this being an app.
Yeah.
Right.
Well,
imagine.
It reminds me of the conversation I had with this guy who created the monitor to you know, check and see like your aerobic threshold, right? Based off of you know, the height of your chest and like the patterns you know, when you breathe. So actually they could accurately predict when you would finish in a marathon. To the very like minute.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah, because of all the aggregated data that they got from that and how this pattern repeated amongst like.
Well, I could see that. You could tell by someone's VO2 max and like, okay, based off of how long this person would be running, on average, they'd probably fall around this time.
But this was even more accurate than the VO2 test and all these metrics they've used before.
There's a lot of things that are unseen that we don't realize will help you predict what's about to happen. We just don't know because we don't know that they exist. Right?
Yeah, we haven't been monitoring them.
We just don't know.
Like using those numbers and watching them.
Like there's this woman, a British lady, who can smell Parkinson's.
What?
What?
Yeah.
Gnarly.
Like, I'm no joke. So she can, let me look it up. She can smell it.
What is that? Like she's accurate, like all the time? Like what's the.
And why just Parkinson's?
She's extremely accurate. Yeah, she's extremely
accurate. Isn't it common to have like the shakes with Parkinson's? You're not very talented if you walk up to people and smell them and their hands are shaking.
No, no. So that's later on.
That would be a little
Adam.
Obvious, yeah.
I think she can smell the Parkinson's before you get the symptoms of it. So I don't think she's walking up to like Michael J. Fox, and she's like, oh, yeah,
son
you definitely.
Of a bitch.
Or, you know, Muhammad
so
Ali. Like, oh, yeah, 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 you look like you got.
This is so yeah. wrong.
Excuse me for interrupting here, but you smell like.
You know what? Yeah, yeah. I have a diagnosis for you.
Hey, oh, that's weird. I could smell obesity. Just walking to someone.
Weird. It smells like farts.
I get the, yeah. So.
Oh, Doug Founder.
Yes. So what they're doing is they're studying her to see how they can develop a test based off of what she's detecting with her nose.
What?
Yes.
That's insane.
Is she the only person that's like this? This is the only person they've ever found?
Well, there's dogs that can smell...
drugs, I know that.
Adam's like,
I've experienced that at the airport. Like, yeah.
No, they don't. I don't. You know, the dogs at the airport aren't there to smell drugs?
Bombs.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
They don't give a shit about drugs. Trust me.
I get it.
I've gone flying with Adam many times.
Oh, phew. Yeah.
Every time there's a dog, I separate myself from Adam.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I have it a plan in my head. Like, I don't know what the fuck that is.
He's on his own.
He would sell me out, dude.
I just keep walking, watch them arrest you. I'll get on the plane. Gotta go. So there's dogs that can smell cancer.
Do you ever wonder why the dogs are there sometimes and then sometimes they're not there?
Just because they probably don't have enough money to have them there all the time.
Well,
so it's random.
Oh, I bet it's random.
You never know.
I bet it's screening. Random. I bet it's real random.
Why do you? Well, I don't get why you're saying that. Why do you think?
Because I find it strange. I find it strange.
Like a conspiracy?
I'm not saying that either. But I'm just saying. I'm just asking you if you know why the dog is there on random fucking days and not other days.
The way you said it made it sound like it's like, yeah. Oh, I know that they're not. You know what I mean? Like wink.
Yeah.
You know, I know what they're doing.
I know what they're up to.
Yeah, I know what those dogs are doing when they're not around.
With the Illuminati.
They're playing cards. They're playing poker. I've seen the picture.
That's right.
No, it's pretty crazy, but they can smell these things in people, so they're actually training dogs to smell cancer.
That's crazy, man.
Yeah.
I mean, it's... I know that...
I don't know what had a smell.
I've heard stories of dogs that they can definitely sense death, and so they'll go to their owner or whoever, and like...
Be like, you're going to die.
Yeah, but like they'll go curl up to him. Like, well, this has happened at like... what do you call those? Like where people are like on their way out. Hospice. Thank you.
Anybody who's had pets for a long time, especially dogs, knows this. Like when you get sick, my dogs know. You could tell they know. You could tell the way they cuddle up to you, they're way gentler.
What do they do when you have sex?
Huh?
What do they do when you have
sex? That's when it gets awkward.
Yeah, yeah, right? I've always wondered that. I never had
like you can close the door, but then they're like, and then they like whine and scratch, and it ruins the mood anyway.
Because so
you gotta let them watch.
I grew up.
They have to learn. Yeah, this is daddy time.
Listen, it's called doggy style. They invented it.
So we learned from them.
I've had dogs my whole life, but they never lived in the house because we're old school Italians, right? Dog lives in the backyard in the doghouse. So I never experienced that, and I've always wondered that. So I figured right now would be a good time to ask.
So
what happens?
It depends.
Are they in the room with you?
Yeah, the ours are always in the room. So they're
what? Yeah. While you're smashing?
Always.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, 100%. They live in our room. So when we go to bed, like, so if Katrina and I are like,
do they not do anything?
Well, sometimes. So
you get a little like cold nose.
First of all, the worst part about having English bulldogs and having sex in the same room is they fart a lot, and they fart a lot at night.
That's not going to kill.
So there's nothing. There's nothing like being in the heat of passion there, and fucking you smell a bulldog fart. You know? So that'll kill it for you sometimes.
Somebody's lying, Adam. I don't think it's the dog. Katrina's like, oh, it's the dog.
Oh my god.
Adam's like, what?
It only doesn't bother me as much as it bothers her. So
that's fucked up, man.
Then sometimes it just depends. Like if it's like a random day sex, right? So then when they have more energy in them, and then they think you're playing. You know, they think you're roughhousing and playing.
Yeah.
And so they're
trying to jump in.
Yeah. So they're trying to jump up on the bed and growling sometimes, and they think that we're playing because it's the middle of the day. But if it's nighttime, it's
Mom
pretty.
And Daddy are wrestling again.
Yeah, nighttime, they know what's up. You know.
I feel weird with the dog in the room.
It is weird at first, but then you get used to it.
My boys will snore right through it, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, they'll snore through it.
You need to boost your game, buddy.
They know what time it is.
Nobody, nothing can sleep in the same room I'm having sex. I'll tell you that right now. Yeah, a dead person will rise from the dead.
I'm not sure, but I thought I heard Jessica say something about your neighbors not even liking you guys. What's
up
with that,
God,
dude?
Why did she make that comment?
She did make that comment. I caught it. It was under her breath. Like you said something. about the neighbors, and then I heard her go, "Oh yeah, they probably don't like
you going all 50 Shades in there. What do you know?
No.
Oh my God.
No, it's just making out. Lots of making out.
Heavy making
heavy,
out.
Heavy making out.
I see.
Wow. Yeah.
Hey, did you hear about the Kid Tech stuff that's going on right now too? So there's
Kid Tech.
Yeah. So there's
that's what I need because I'm not good with adult tech.
There's a huge rise right now in these companies to police all these platforms.
What do you mean, police? So this is like
like YouTube, like not having real kid friendly stuff.
Police is not
monitored.
The right word. Police is not the right word.
Yeah, regulate.
These are private companies that are offering these services up. So
we need them, dude. YouTube's fucked up.
Oh yeah,
that's exactly why
these creepers coming
it's
in.
It's doing so well.
Kids.
It's because it's YouTube is having a hard time with policing it themselves or controlling it. And so what we're having is these other companies that are coming up as a second party that will filter it out. So I think how it works.
You know how big the market, the consumer market is on YouTube? That is kids.
Yeah, that's what. This,
oh yeah,
they're this
and
company
they're being underserved, and tech is definitely. I mean, what kid isn't like on tech these days?
Well, hold on. This is brilliant actually, because you have Nickelodeon, which exploded when we were kids.
Yeah.
It was the first network for kids. Remember
just
that?
Just for kids, yeah.
Remember that? And it went crazy.
All the shows are all directed.
You got to know 100% exactly what they're building.
Yeah,
for
yeah,
that,
yeah.
They're going to do YouTube for kids.
They've already got a $100 million evaluation, dude. I mean, it's
smart.
The market's there.
I can't believe it's taking this long,
Speaking of Nickelodeon, last night I showed my son a classic. Do you guys watch Nickelodeon when you were kids?
Oh,
right?
I loved it. Yeah, that slime. What do they call that?
Do you guys remember the show?
Double dare.
Yeah.
Yes.
Come on now.
Yeah, double dare.
Yeah. Do you guys remember the show You Can't Do That on Television?
Yeah.
Oh, wasn't that good?
It was good.
So did you ever watch that?
I can't remember.
I vaguely remember.
It's an old like skit show with kids acting out skits, and there's this one guy, and one of the common skits is they're at school in the cafeteria, and the cook's always putting something gross in their food.
Oh, right.
And then there's one guy where he's like one of the kids will be like in front of a pole, and he's like a military guy, and he's gonna say ready, aim, fire, but the kid always tricks him to getting in front of the guns and saying fire. And you remember that?
I mean, kind of. Yeah, like a little bit.
Was it like the edgy, rebellious, like?
It was for that time. So when I put it on for my kid, I told my son, I'm like, oh, this was so inappropriate.
Yeah,
and he watched it. He's like, pff.
Yeah, lame. Yeah.
No, it's. I'm gonna pull it up.
Now he's watching Rick and Morty.
I feel like I remember.
I'm
going to
play
that.
The intro for you, and then we'll see if you guys. And slime came from, I think, the show.
Oh, yeah. I just remember they'd punk people.
Remember that?
Let me see the video.
Remember this, right?
I totally remember that.
Oh,
the intro and everything. I just don't remember the sketches.
Oh, it's so good. So I watched out my
what
kids
year,
last
What
night.
Year was it?
They're old.
It was 90 or something, right?
No, I think
That's
they're 80. I think,
it looks 80
I
right
think
there.
They were reruns when we watched them because I think they were filmed in like the 70s.
Wow. Oh, shit. Okay. So it goes back there.
So it was old when we were kids.
It looks like it.
Good times. Justin, you had something that you wanted to...
I did. So speaking of reminiscing, so here's a good transition.
How's
for
that
you.
Transition
yeah,
there?
Yeah.
Like that yeah, so
super smooth.
Hey, hey there. You had something you're going to ring up there. Hey. Yeah. So remember Barney? I mean, who doesn't? Like,
of course.
I love you.
We do. Of course. We do love each
yeah,
other.
We all hated him.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
We actually had like parties we talked about, you know, we killed him. Anyways, so apparently the actor that played Barney.
How old is he now?
He's got to be, I mean, maybe 50s.
What does he look like? I feel like he's
purple with
he's a
green
black
belly.
Guy. And he, so here you go. So here's the title for you of this, right? Former Barney, the dinosaur actor, now works as a controversial tantric sex guru.
Oh, what?
Yes!
Shut your face.
So it's like, so and the hilarious part is all his clients, female. Yeah.
How do you become a tantric sex guru?
Exactly.
Where do you go to
work?
School for that?
Yeah, I don't know. But
can someone Google that?
Apparently people are opting in.
Put Google how to become a tantric sex guru.
Yeah.
If there's a certification course.
Yeah, so he's 52 years old.
It'd be silly that we didn't take it.
Yeah. And if there is no certification course.
It'd be silly we didn't start one.
Guess what's in my title?
Yeah.
Sal DiStefano.
Dude, he charges $350
fitness professional.
Dollars for a 4-hour session.
How much?
$350.
He's just masturbating them.
Yeah.
Whoa.
That's what I feel like. I feel like that's what he's
it's
doing.
It's like the old doctors.
It's like the old doctors.
Oh, wow.
The worst part is he says...
He's giving them hand jobs.
He was saying that like his acting skills like as Barney like helped prep him for this somehow. And I'm like, that's the creepiest thing like I've
what?
Ever heard.
Well, think of the song.
Like love.
I love you.
You know, like
you
he's all me. Like, yeah. This what whole tantric is, mindset. Towards
now, I don't know anything about tantric sex. So
I thought
what
it was
I'm about
just,
to say is
okay.
based off of me totally guessing. But is it where you're supposed to prolong the arousal period and yeah. not orgasm?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You said that very confidently, Adam.
Well, because I know that much. I don't
well,
know.
It's
much
like, you, oh, okay. like yeah. you get to the you get to like the threshold of the orgasm and then you pull back, right? Is that isn't that the
No,
move?
That's actually a different how you train maneuver? Yourself to last longer. Oh. That's an old technique.
Yeah.
This is
but what is tantric? This is a course right here. That
yeah, this is tantric up. Yoga. Tantra yoga.
I guess if
was this what Mike Bledsoe was talking about that one time?
Maybe. You know, a lot of times I don't know what he's saying. So tantric, I feel like if you put that in front of anything, you're going to get more people wanting to do it.
Oh, yeah. You're going to get $350, apparently.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like if it's like, you know, hey, come join my HIIT workout.
But it's tantric everyone's
like,
HIIT.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, today we're doing tantric HIIT.
Like
everybody's
ooh.
Yeah. Oh wow.
Yeah. Should I bring? How do you get should I bring a robe or what?
I want to know how you become a guru though. How do you,
I
how
think
do you,
it's just self proclaimed. Because
you, yeah. you can hold it the longest, maybe.
Well, that would be. I don't think so.
I mean, how do
you, maybe he's got like super skills. You know.
I mean, in our world, if you're a guru and something like that, you have to put in because you're a master at what 5,000 hours.
Yeah. He's
so
some
gurus
10,
above
000
that.
In.
That's 10,000.
Yeah.
10,000 orgasms?
At least, right?
Is that what that would be?
That would add, I mean, so, if you're doing the math.
Is that so, a lot? 3, 6, 7,
I don't know. So carry
the one.
Check
two.
This out. I have, I know somebody who knows somebody. This is how I protect their identity.
Okay.
Who they...
what he means is me. He goes...
yeah, I'm about to talk about Adam.
I know somebody
right
who knows somebody.
Let's just call him Madam.
Madam.
Anyway. No, so I know somebody who knows somebody who... So this guy... couple married, nice people, but very hippie-ish, if you will.
So not full hippie, but ish.
No, very.
Oh, okay.
So they're way.
So
they're
it wouldn't
way,
be ish. It'd just be very hippie.
Very hippie, right? Yeah. So they're all the way on that side. So the guy, while they were married, nice people, the guy decided, I'm just going to be celibate now.
What?
Yeah, like I'm just not gonna
like.
Yeah,
I'm over it.
Yeah, I'm not gonna have sex anymore.
What?
Yeah, so because he felt like this was his, I don't know what his path or whatever, like I'm going to do this to, it's
oh,
something
for
about.
Religious purposes?
No, it's not a religious thing. Something about him, I don't know, something like he believed in, like I'm going to not have sex anymore. So his wife is like, okay, so they just don't have sex. That's it.
That's it.
End
that's
of
the
story.
End of it.
That's the end of story.
Like put it in a
how old are they?
And bury it.
They're like, well, now they're probably in their late 30s.
Oh, they're that young.
Yeah. So they just decided.
Because I could get that if you're, I mean, how many relationships kind of already do that already when you start getting into the late 40s and 50s? I mean,
not
I've,
much. Not oh, healthy had, ones. Not healthy ones.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, you know how many clients I trained
yeah,
where
right.
they were only having sex once
that's
a month?
That's when you get, that? Yeah, the separate bed thing.
Yeah,
and all
dude,
that.
That's
that
a real,
out of control.
That's a real fucking deal. And I know people that
I'm
are listening
that
are only like 20-something or 30-something, you're going like, yeah, right. But there's it's more common than you think because
well, so
I've trained
just,
a lot of fucking
well,
people.
Well, they're healthy people too. You know, and so here's the thing about the guy. He says after a while he started having wet dreams because your body has to.
Oh yeah, it has to emit.
Has to let.
I bet that's
the,
awesome.
Emit that.
To, what?
To have, that would have been awesome to have an adult
so,
wet dream.
So
did you have? You,
so
I don't
long.
Get no wet dreams.
Did you guys ever get wet dreams?
Yeah,
no,
man.
I never even really got
me
any.
Neither.
No, I didn't get no wet.
Do you know
I
why?
A lot
you,
of them.
Do you know why you didn't get a lot?
Because I masturbated
you were jerking
too much.
Off all the time.
I didn't. Because I didn't know how.
Justin
was
took me a long time to figure out the technique.
You need to
had a girl actually teach me. I told you guys this.
Did you?
No, she taught me how to do it.
Hold on a second. Knowing Justin.
Wait.
He probably
you,
hurt himself.
Could you specify yeah. who the girl was?
She was my girlfriend.
Okay, was it your mom or anything?
Come
oh
on,
God,
dude.
What's
wrong with you? What's Adam is way too high.
I know.
This is not something a sober guy would say.
Oh, God. You
know, oh, man.
I knew you were close to your mom.
Come on, dude. Like, you just put that image in my head. Like, how dare you?
That's the most
like, that's just so wrong.
That's the most random thing I've ever heard in my life.
It's wrong.
No, but, you know, knowing Justin.
We'll move on.
Knowing yeah. Justin as yeah. well as we do, as I do now, for sure he didn't know what the fuck he was doing.
No, I did it. I had no idea,
all
man.
All aggressive.
So, Making a mess, you know, using glue. Oh, it's not working.
It's not working, man. No,
so Justin will do things sometimes.
Yeah.
And so we were in, when we were in LA, this is a great story. We're fucking, we're in LA and we podcasted hard in LA. We went hard. We did a lot of work.
We did.
We're
about we to lived on, up to the shirt.
We're about to go on a trip now. That's going to be like that. But anyway, Justin and Drew, we're all eating sushi and they're like, oh, let's do a sake bomb. Does anybody else anybody else want to do a sake bomb? Everybody's like, nah, we're cool. And by the way, Drew is like, you know, he's like pussies. 21 years old, right? He's like a kid, right? So they're sitting there. They got the sake bombs and they're like, they start to drink it. Well, I don't know what came over Justin, but he's like, I'm going to fucking pound this thing like I'm in a race. It just destroys it.
It just brought it all back.
It just turned the whole cup upside down.
For no reason. Yeah. Just spilled it on his sides. It's like, oh, like if he was in a college.
He turned a cup upside down like it was a beer bottle.
Yeah, just
as if his mouth was all the way over the tire.
It was this weird, like he was right next to me. He was drinking at the same time. You know, it's like, no. Yeah. You know, like put it all down.
And so
that's his competitiveness coming out.
And that's why I said when he did it, I'm like, that was. There's no one that's more. I mean, he's the most Justin person I know. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, because you don't know him.
I definitely do my own thing.
When you get to know Justin, you know what a Justin thing is to do. Like when he eats food.
Yeah.
Like that.
Everybody gets grossed out when I do farmer blows and yeah. You know,
what's like a farmer blow?
You do that a lot. I've never seen you do that.
Thank God. It's not what
Courtney
I thought it was.
Courtney sees me do that. She hates when I do that.
I thought it was something else. I was like, please God, let it be something else. Everyone gets grossed out when I blow a farmer.
Yeah.
So what? Weird.
I've never been able to do that.
What?
What do you call the farmer? I didn't even know it had a name. First
really?
Have you tried it?
Yeah, of course. I tried it. After you fail like three times, you don't do it no more.
What do you? What ends up? It just hits your face?
Yeah.
I don't carry a handkerchief on me. You know what I mean?
I think every guy that's ever seen somebody do that at one point goes, fuck, can I do that? And then you try and do it, and it just
you
some
get
people,
it all over yourself.
Yeah, you get it all over your shirt. Fucking,
I got that technique down.
You gotta have enough power.
You don't have enough.
It's all horsepower. It's 100% horsepower.
You know what, Justin? You bring up an interesting point.
Yeah.
I wonder if that'll ever come back. Handkerchiefs,
handkerchief.
Yeah.
Chief
and pocket watches.
Pocket watches
already
are cool.
Is like the steampunk thing.
Yeah, you know? But a handkerchief
that had its thing.
You know why I think handkerchiefs went out of style? Because you blow your nose in it and then you save it.
Yeah. I know, that's gross.
How does that
work? Yeah, you fold it and then like put it back in your pocket.
Does it dry and then it's good again?
Yeah, it dries and you don't use that side. Then you wash it.
Is that how it works?
Uh-huh.
Oh, man.
What do you
handkerchief.
Do? Handkerchief. What do you mean? What do you do different?
Do you know how people use them? They blow their nose in there and then they fold it and they put it in your pocket.
You put it in your pocket. Yeah. You use it again or not, and then you wash it, you know, once you're
done. Right. Yeah. You didn't know that?
Well, I did, but that's now that I'm talking about it, it's kind of gross.
Yeah.
My grandfather.
You have to kind of live with your own boogers, you know, like. In your pocket.
Yeah, my grandfather had a handkerchief.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We did a lot of gross things back in the day before we could pollute the earth and throw things away.
You know what else is crazy?
What?
This guy.
What
right?
guy?
He self-proclaimed.
The transitions are fire.
Time.
Could you please smoke some more weed, please?
Wasn't that a good one?
Just say it.
He's a self-proclaimed time traveler.
Next time, say, please, I'm going to make a transition right
here. Hold on. This is
and transition.
This sounds interesting.
You know what Yuri's from? I'll give you a guess.
Where?
3,300.
Oh, wow. So he says he came from the year 3,300?
He came from the year 3,300.
Well, fucking break it down. What's this guy got for us?
He's like catastrophic future. Apparently, like there's one mother computer that basically is going to kill everybody. Except for him. Yeah. Well, he's coming. He's traveling back to warn us that the robots are going to take over.
Yeah. Do you know how I know time travel will never happen?
Why is that?
Because we've never had refugees from the future. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, nobody's ever done that. Like, nobody's ever come back and be like, all right, everybody. You fucked up right here. Stop this experiment. You know what I mean? So that's why I feel like time travel has never been invented.
I always love listening to the details of these people that, like, you know, they have all these claims and stuff. Like, he said he was in the army. He got drafted in the army and they wore, like, all gold uniforms. And it's like... what kind of acid or, you know, what was he on where he just like constructed all this, like all his ideas and all of his details?
Have you ever gone and talked to like a fortune teller or a medium or anyone like that before?
No, I've always wanted to.
I know. Because maybe we should do that.
You have that? Oh, that would be great.
Yeah, I did.
We should do that and then talk about that.
You ready for some weird shit? I'll tell you some of the stuff.
So, I know, bro. I'm always ready. Everybody I know has been to one.
Well, no, mine's really fucking weird.
Yeah.
So I did this back when I had my personal training studio. And I asked a bunch of questions and we were talking. And so I'm super skeptical of this kind of stuff to the point where someone had bought me a gift certificate to talk to this lady because they loved her. And when I called the lady up, she's like, oh, when would you like to come in? I said, actually, can I do this over the phone? Why do you guys think I chose over the phone?
Oh, yeah. She can't read in your body language.
Yeah, because I'm thinking like these are experts at reading body language and moving in.
Yeah, but now she can use Google without you checking her.
So I'm like,
exactly.
Well, this is back when I had my
backfire.
No. This is back when I had my wellness studio.
Come on, man.
There was no information on me at all.
There
was nothing.
There's a lot of information.
There was nothing on me.
Well,
so,
as much as
but anyway, let me tell my story.
Anyway, yeah,
let me tell my story.
Yeah, sure. So you just fucked my story.
So there was no mind pump. What did she look up on Google? You know what I mean?
I mean, she might be like a hacker.
She can tell me some facts about real shit, but that's different. So anyway. Did it over the phone so she couldn't read my body language. I was very quiet over the phone. I wasn't like, oh my God, or this and that. But when she was freaking me out, I covered the phone and I'd be like, holy shit. So she was telling me some weird stuff. So first she tells me about my relationship. Well, you know, by the time I'm married, you know, at this time I'm married. And she said stuff like, well, because I asked her like, we're having a lot of trouble. Like what do you see there? Like what's going on? Actually, no, I didn't say we're having a lot of trouble. I said, what do you see in my future for my family? That's what I said. She goes, well, you and your wife, you know, you really care about your kids and that'll help you. And I'm like, what do you mean? Like, what do you mean by that? That'll help us. She goes, well, you're probably not going to be together. And I said, really? And so we went into that a little bit, which is kind of weird. Then she went into a few other things that were very strange. But here's the weird thing. She said something to me that resonated, but I had no idea why it resonated. So while we're talking on the phone, she's paused as she's talking and she gets real excited. Now she says it's because she gets this information from, I don't know where, right?
Yes,
so I'm like, oh, that's a nice act. But she, whatever, who knows, right? So
start speaking tongues.
She does, she gets this and she starts like screaming on the phone, getting excited. And she goes, I swear on my life, I have the notes because I know you cocksuckers are going to fucking think I'm lying. I have the notes.
I believe you, bro.
That's so aggressive.
She says, Sal, she goes, you're Oprah. This is on the mind. I'm like, what? She's like, you're going to be just like Oprah. I'm like, what do you mean? You know, and it was resonating when she was saying this. She's like, you're going to be talking to people. This is what you're going to do. You're going to influence people, this and that and the other. And
she called you Oprah?
Swear on my life.
Wow.
And it was very weird, but I had no
knowledge.
Did
you tell her you were black?
Yeah.
Well,
I'm like, well, I want to be a woman.
It's all that charisma coming through the phone, man.
I barely said any words. Yeah. How weird is that? And I have the notes and I saved them because I thought it was so strange. And now we have, now, of course, here's the thing about these type of things.
If it could
be
Oprah,
interpreted.
What does that make Justin and I? Dr. Oz?
I'm Dr. Phil.
Dr. Phil?
Yeah. Hey.
Dr. Oz and Dr. Phil? Yeah.
So,
I'll take it.
You know what's the thing? So here's the thing about this.
I'm
kind
a fake
of stuff.
Doctor.
Let's say she said I'm going to be like Oprah, and then I end up, you know, liking poetry and, you know, wanting to help charities. And I'm like, oh my God, that's what she meant. So my point is, sometimes people will say these things, and if they feel right to you, you can almost justify or connect them to whatever. You know what I'm saying? Because it could be a lot of things that I could do that would be like, oh,
it's
yeah,
like
I'm
like horoscopes,
Oprah.
Dude.
Yeah.
It's like the way you read them, like everyone's horoscopes. Like,
although mine is accurate.
Always.
No, not my horoscope.
Is that where they get all their powers?
But my profile.
Can we please revisit Justin's theory?
I really like the
Google, like that she actually might have some Google skills too.
I feel like it. I mean, I feel like you have some Google powers you're not using, you know?
What do you mean?
I mean, like you can summon like
information
things really
on
quickly.
Google?
I mean, you
it's
should use that. Yeah, you should use that as a predictive.
I do every day. Yeah. Anyway,
I'm telling you.
neither one of you have ever been to a psychic?
No.
Nothing.
But I know people that have, and everybody that has have all told me crazy stories.
I know. Even my sister-in-law, who's the most skeptical, has said that.
I've actually never had somebody, I will say, I've never had somebody who's gone and seen one and been like, oh, that's a bunch of bullshit.
Well, of Almost course not. They're like, embarrassed.
Right.
Wait, no one's going to tell you they wasted $100. You know what I mean?
Well, no, I would think that I've probably had somebody who actually went with that intention of, let's go try this out, and been skeptical about it, you know, but...
Yeah, here's why I'm skeptical.
I'm trying to think of somebody who's...
Why I'm skeptical, because first of all, we've never seen a news headline that said Psychic wins the lottery. Never. Every time I've met a psychic, they're always like, what's your name? Tell me about yourself. Yeah. Like, why? You know, and maybe it's not, maybe it doesn't work that way, right? Maybe you can't summon it that way.
Right, right.
But I do feel like
the way
by now
like
you should be able to.
Software, though. You know what I mean? Like, that's the direction my mind goes these days, just because, like, now if it's accurate, it's like you could get so much information from Facebook alone on somebody to kind of piece it all together and like see who they're interacting with, and like you could do that like fairly quickly.
Well, if I'm sure there's a difference between all of them, right? Like a fortune teller versus a medium. Like I think a medium believes that they are communicating to the other side. They're communicating to another dimension, and whether it be your future self or a relative to you or what that, like that's their way.
Now,
of explaining.
isn't because I know you guys are all, you know, Team Jesus and stuff. Supposed to be bad? Aren't you supposed to not talk to people like that?
Using the devil's powers.
Well, I mean, yeah, it wouldn't be ideal. It'd be being tempted, be going somewhere like that where you could be tempted.
So you want to go to a fortune teller, but you massive pussies will not do a Ouija board with me.
That's different. No, the,
you know. Why is that different?
It's just different.
He's like, yeah. Listen to you guys fumble.
It doesn't work. You know, like I've been in.
It's because of the scary movies when we were kids, bro.
I'll buy it. I'll do it.
What movie was that with a Ouija board?
Don't bring that kind of energy in here.
Yeah,
what energy?
What's wrong with you?
What energy? Bring your crystals.
You believe in energy.
Huh?
It's a fucking
energy
game you buy. I think Hasbro makes it.
Why are you stuck on it, dude?
You guys are scared about
Hasbro. The same people that be giving kids gummy bears are giving Ouija boards out?
I think Hasbro doesn't sell gummy bears.
Yeah, they do.
No, Hasbro's a toy company.
Yeah.
Hasbro does gummy bears, too.
Oh, you're thinking
Haribo. Haribo. Yeah, it's very, very close.
Oh, there's
it's
that just dyslexia. Like library.
Yeah. That's Haribo. Yeah.
Yeah. It's very electronical.
Hasbro. Yeah. That sounds like a dude that lifts weights from the past.
Hasbro. You're such a Hasbro. Yeah.
Fuck you guys.
No, dude. No, but I want to bring a Ouija board because I want to. I think it would be a
bro,
great.
Not why? Here.
All right, hold on a second.
Not here.
Hold on a second.
No.
Hold on a second.
You're sorcery.
There's one group of people that have never led us wrong. Okay. So. I'd like to ask the audience if you think we should use a Ouija board and film it.
No way, dude.
Just DM Adam so he knows you're serious DM about this.
I'll bring my
holy
water.
You're about to get 1,000 DMs.
You know what I mean?
Holy water.
I already got, you know what, by the way, I made the mistake, I think, on one of the last podcasts of telling people that I answer all my DMs, and then I got fucked for that one for
sure.
You
got a whole bunch of them. Yeah. Why'd you lie?
Yeah,
you never answered DMs.
Well, no,
why
now,
you lie?
Now I have a hard time. So if I said that, you just, and then now you reached out to me, you and a bunch of other people. So it's been taking me a while to get all the way.
There's
through.
A little bit of a buzz going on right now. I feel like there's a lot more activity.
It seems like
around
it.
The show. Yeah,
it seems like it. There's been.
I mean, we just went to LA and went crazy, and now we're about to go to Tampa. Which, by the way, can we just tell the audience how fucked up our travel's gonna be?
It's all over the place.
We're gonna leave at like 9:45 p.m.
Yeah, from San Francisco,
and arrive there at 6 a.m.
Yes, and then hop on another plane from Miami to Tampa.
This is a terrible idea.
It's going to be
but whatever.
Challenging, but we podcast hard.
Yeah, it's the thing. You know, here's the deal. Like, we podcast harder than your podcast.
For you, for the fans.
Yeah, we could podcast harder than your podcast. That's the new the new tagline.
How hard is your podcast?
You know what I mean?
I like that. Yeah. I like that.
Speaking of hard, you know, chaga might be a libido booster.
Where did you hear that?
Well, no, I've been taking the four sigmatic chaga consistently. And
been getting them chaga boners.
And I don't know, you know, I didn't know if that's something that it does. You know, here's the thing about the four sigmatic supplements. There's a lot of supplements that I've tried all of them, okay, by the way. Very few will you notice actual effects from. The four sigmatic ones I do, when I take them, I can tell something's happening. Now, I do cycle them because I do believe that your body does develop a tolerance to anything that has an effect on you. Like anything you take that you feel, you know, theoretically, your body will try to adapt to it by reducing the effect. So I cycle. So I was doing the lion's mane, right? That's what I was doing a lot of, which is just a great nootropic. I combine lion's mane, caffeine, and if I really want to go crazy, throw some ketones and some CBD in there, and then I'm brilliant. Or just lion's mane by itself.
So that's the formula.
That's the selling point right there. So that's what I was doing for a little while. Now I'm on to chaga, and I love the immediate relaxing effects of chaga. It's not sleepy, though. It's kind of like this calm feeling. So I'm not so irritated at Adam all the time. So I have it, and I feel...
you got to get me on that one.
But now, I've been taking chaga now consistently for...
I feel like I've been pretty calm lately.
You're a lot more
I'm
teasing
you,
bro.
Right?
I'm teasing you.
We haven't had chill. We actually haven't had a major... You know, disagreement. Remember, we used to have him out on the show all the time.
Who? Yeah. No, we had a few episodes. No,
way back in the days. No way. Yes, we have.
It was like a handful.
Yeah. Well, you're right. Okay, there's probably about a handful.
But anyway, chaga, good stuff for boners. And you're right. But we did. There was a couple episodes where we were a little bit back and forth, you and I. Yeah. And then the forum got all... Everybody gets all...
Yeah. It's like really worried.
Gang wars right away. Yeah. Bloods and Crips all of a sudden separate. It's like, whoa, dude, chill out.
We should do that. We should come up with a topic that we actually really disagree on and then debate it on the podcast.
Well, a lot of times, too, that there's...
Like shoes.
But that's a stupid debate. You know what I mean?
See, it's you. Maybe not to Adam.
Well, I mean, it's his expertise. I don't care.
Oh, I wouldn't say I'm
an expert at all.
Well,
I think
compared to me,
there we go.
Taylor,
compared to me, you're a genius with shoes. I don't even know what I'm wearing right now. You know what I mean? What are these, Converse? I think they're Converse.
Isn't it funny how there are certain things, though, that people are really passionate about and then other people just don't give two shits about, and there are certain things in your life that you're extremely passionate about, others don't. I find that really fascinating how we're so unique and different like that. And
I got excited about my old encyclopedia set that you guys made fun of. It looks so cool up there.
Right.
That's great.
I was just, can I tell you something?
That's why people don't think I'm confrontational, because I just, like, the topics that we're arguing, I don't care. Yeah. Like, I'm still waiting.
You're still waiting.
Still waiting on Justin's the one, like, that I care about.
I don't care about fitness.
No, I care about fitness, but we don't argue about that. It's always some other weird thing.
Well, why don't you say something that you think is controversial, and then me and Adam
I know that's
try
a problem. I don't know.
I don't think you have to. You don't have too many things that
you know
we
what it
do?
Is. Debate. Yeah, I don't know. What it is that we're really convincing, and so Justin's just waiting to see who he sides with.
Yeah, I wait to form an opinion for the
he
most
does.
Part.
He
yeah.
does.
Yeah. After we're done, he's always like,
I think it's a pretty.
And I'll take sides.
It's a pretty.
I'll take sides after the argument.
It's pretty even split, I think.
Yeah.
Winning Justin over.
Man, you guys are always like working on this. Like, I've noticed it. I go in a line, like, no, he's going to go in my line, dude. And you guys are like betting back and forth on like what I'm going to do. You're trying to fucking manipulate me.
I started that because I know how you are. Because you got in line with Adam. So I'm like, oh, you're just going to follow Adam. And I knew
I
that
know,
just
but that's
say
so
that
funny. That hits my psychology so hard, dude. I'm just like, I don't want to fucking have preferential shit over here. Like, I'm my own man.
It all started when you referred to Sal as the best closer.
I knew it.
That was it. It started 3 years ago.
I'm wondering what would happen
when Sal pigeonholed you into answering that. And I thought, you motherfucker.
You know what happened? Like, if I would have gone the other direction, Sal, like, he would have just been jabbing at me like forever.
It's you know?
Well, I knew Adam could take it.
And you would have had to had to live with yourself for being dishonest. You're such an honest person.
Yeah.
Your integrity's top.
I love how you spin everything, dude. You're so good at it.
You know, the guy can't lie. He can't lie. It's one of those things.
That's right. I'm like
Adam will never like live that down.
Abraham Lincoln,
you know
what I mean?
Because like he hired you, right, Justin? So you were like his dude.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. So like, he came in with Adam. So there's already this like
he heard you say team. That. He was like his heart was like. He's like, no.
Not my Justin.
Can we please release at least to our private forum the forbidden episode of the four with all the guys, the sales guys.
Oh my! Ooh. Yeah, I love how you put us on the spot.
Yeah, I am trying to put you guys on the spot because I think at least the forum will really appreciate it.
I personally enjoyed it.
I thought it was a great conversation. This conversation right now is reminding me of that, and so I'm like, man, our forum
was
a little crazier, but
old friends. It was two old friends. So here, I'll tell you, I'll break it down for everybody so they know. That way, when you don't listen to it, you'll be even more angry. Two guys that used to. So I both of them worked for me, and then one of them worked with Adam, and then the other one became good friends with Adam. So me and Adam are really good friends with these two guys. They also happen to be two of the best. Absolute best salespeople
and humans
great people, but also great sales guys, super charismatic, but also off the wall. And when we all get together, we didn't all four hang out together ever.
Yeah, so actually, like, that's the first time we were ever all together.
And if you guys like listening right now, you hear me and Adam go off sometimes and we don't want to shut up. Now throw two more versions of those people in the room, and you have me, Adam, Larry, and Jason, who are good friends. and it just went off. And then we started telling stories, and it got super inappropriate.
That's where it started to get fun.
Super inappropriate, super terrible.
Well, the one, I think why, so we have a lot of forum members that have listened to the old episodes where we used to tell a lot of gym stories.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't
told a lot.
I mean, I want to say the first 100-something episodes, it seemed like every week we were doing gym stories where we shared old stories that people love. We haven't done something like that. Well, that episode was like that. It was just, you know, all of our experiences working together and some shit that I forgot some of the stuff, man. Larry and Jay both brought up some things that I had. Oh man, I had forgotten all about that.
Oh boy, yep. It got really crazy. But anyway, good friends of ours, excellent salespeople, totally different, by the way. These two guys are totally different in their sales approach.
Yeah.
But they're both very effective. So we had a little pissing contest between the four of us. Who's the best, you know, communicator or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty funny. So, but I did convince everybody to say Jason. So I think I won that. Just kidding.
Bring on the bird, Doug. Or we got Thrive Unboxing.
Yeah, we got a box here.
Oh, let's see what you got here.
So last week we had a keto box. So
box looks light, Doug.
Yeah, it's small.
Is it lighter than the other ones?
This is a smaller one. We just have three items only in it.
Oh, okay. I see.
And so I ordered off the keto menu at Thrive Market,
mm-hmm.
and I kind of went the dessert sweet angle here.
Oh, shit.
So let's open
up the box.
Is it going to melt? Will it melt?
Yeah, it could melt if you left it out in the car.
Oh, okay.
Ooh, throw that over here, Doug.
Yeah, so the first thing is the original fat fudge.
Oh, yeah. I love this stuff.
That's all just right there.
It has grass-fed butter, tahini,
help you paint
cacao,
them toilets, buddy.
Coffee in it. And you can either take it, you know, straight, or you can
anyway.
Put it in your coffee.
Producing that fat fudge.
If Justin was a rapper, that would be his nickname.
Yeah.
Fat fudge.
Fat fudge in the house.
The next thing we have here is off the hook.
Oh, wow.
His first album, Painted Toilets.
Painted Toilets, Soiled Dreams. Yeah. Fat fudge coming in hot.
You know what was even funnier? You know what's even funnier? What was the name of your band?
Bloodshed Promise.
That was his actual band.
Yeah.
Which is kind of, it is good. Yeah. But it's fine. Anyway, sorry, Doug.
Okay.
I promise there will be bloodshed.
We're off the chain. Sorry.
Yeah, no worries. We've got mint cream coconut butter cups from Eating Evolved.
God. Oh, my God.
Is there dairy in those, Doug? Because I want to try them.
Let's see here. Let's see if I can get the ingredients here. There is no dairy.
Oh, man.
Yeah, it's all coconut-based.
Sizzle snap.
And then the final thing we have here is cocoa nut protein bars by EXO. So you know what that means? If they're from EXO.
Are they on it?
No.
No, that's the one.
Hugs and Kisses?
No, they contain cricket.
Oh!
These are cricket bars.
Okay, that's what that means.
You guys try that one. I'll take your
word. The bug bars?
I like cricket protein.
Yeah, so that's
you guys
it
were all over
week.
The chips, man.
You know what? You know what's brilliant? You know what's brilliant about the cricket products?
What?
Like, they'll never get a return because you find an insect in them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Stupid. Like you find, there's
true.
A cricket in my shit. And they'll be like, no, well, yeah.
Added protein.
That's what
just,
it is.
We bumped it up for you.
What if you, like, you'll find.
That's your third dad joke of the day today.
Yeah.
What was the one he did earlier?
On a tear.
When we were driving to lunch, what did he say?
Oh no. So
Hertz rent a car?
Yeah.
I said, don't rent a car from there. It's painful.
Because it's
boom.
Painful.
Yeah. You know, if my kids would love that joke.
I'm sure they would.
Yeah. All right. So now bring on the bird, please.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First question is from Sydney Elise 00. How do you know whether a full body versus body part split is right for you?
You have to try them out, obviously, to know. That's the answer. However, if you are 85%, if you're
going to lean on the fact that total body is probably going to do you better.
Yeah, I this is just a general estimation, and you know it's funny. I read a few articles on this when I was first putting out the MAPS program because I wanted to see how many people have talked about comparing the two programs, at least in modern coaches. And I can't remember where the article was, but I found an article and there were, I think, eight strength and conditioning coaches, very well-known ones, And every single one of them agreed that the vast majority of people will build the most muscle strength and get the best performance out of a full body routine. In my estimation, probably 8 or 9 out of every 10 people that I've ever trained do better on a full body program.
I would agree with that.
And those are the people who are seriously interested in building muscle. If I include all my average clients, it's more like 95% mm-hmm. where full body works best. So for most people, it's just more effective. And one of the main reasons why is that a body part split simply doesn't send a muscle building signal frequently enough to the muscles. So if I hit, you know, chest on one day and back on another day and shoulders on another day, it's going to take me 7 days before I hit that same body part again. And resistance training is quite, there is a general effect, but there is obviously a very localized effect. In other words, if I just train my biceps will grow and I won't get any growth in my calves. So you have to hit the body parts more frequently for most people than once every 7 days.
Well, and I also feel with split, it's way easier to over-intensify your workout sessions to where it leads you, like, where you're just repairing damage, you know, the rest of the days in between. And it goes back to that old way of thinking that, like, getting really super sore is a good thing, as opposed to then, you know, adapting versus, you know, repair, you know, damage. So, you know, total body workouts, it just... If you know that tomorrow I have to do another one, you're already have that reserve to, you know, overextend yourself, overexert yourself. So
why does it have to be like an either or though? You know, like
good
I don't,
point.
I don't
it
feel,
doesn't. Yeah,
I don't feel like it just needs to be an either or. I think that understanding the benefits of the full body, the major benefits you're getting is what Sal's saying is the frequency that you're going to get. So. But maybe you really like the body part split because it works with your schedule and you enjoy that and it's easier for you just to focus on a couple body parts at a time. I mean, you could do like a push-pull type of split where you're still going to hit every muscle group
point.
2 to 3 times in a week, and that could be extremely – someone could have a lot of success.
Because that's the real issue, right? It's not that it's full body.
Right.
It's that you're hitting the muscles more frequently than once a week, which body part splits are typically each body part once a week. So – could you do a split that takes advantage of more frequency? Absolutely. In fact, if we were to program a split, that's what it would do. We would make sure we took care of frequency because frequency is extremely important because we know that when you lift weights,
yeah.
If I hit my chest, we know that the muscle protein synthesis rate goes up right afterwards and spikes at like 48 to 72 hours, but then it drops very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's 3 days after I hit my chest, but I still have 4 days more until I hit my chest, that muscle building signal now is dropping. And not only does it drop, it drops quickly. And then it goes down below baseline because your body is always adapting. It's either trying to, so muscles are building or they're shrinking.
Mm-hmm.
They don't really maintain, if you will. And it happens on a microscopic level. So sometimes it builds, sometimes it shrinks. And so you end up staying around the same. But that's kind of how it works. So if you hit your body parts once a week, the odds are it's just not frequent enough. Now, the big question is this, because I guarantee there's people listening right now who are like, well, then why do bodybuilders work out? Like, why is body part split the most common training system or program then for bodybuilders? Like, what is it about the split in bodybuilding then if it's not the best for building muscle? Well, the people that represent bodybuilding that we hear from are typically the better bodybuilders. So we don't hear from people who train like a bodybuilder but never step on stage and don't really look that good.
Right. I would venture to argue that most of those bodybuilders have pretty damn good genetics that they could almost do whatever they want and they're going to still build.
I wouldn't be surprised if their muscle building signal spiked and stayed elevated for 2 or 3 times longer than the average person.
I met a lot of pros. You know what I'm saying? I met a lot of pros and got a chance to kind of see like how some of these guys train and stuff. And there's a lot of them that use mainly gear to change, you know, their size up or down. They would just add certain anabolics to get bigger. It wasn't done in their program.
The routine doesn't even change.
The routine stays the same like all the time. And it's crazy. And it's all based off intensity. Maybe during prep time, they pick it up and they go harder or whatever with that, or just add sets of reps. But there's no real rhyme or reason. And their bodies aren't really changing much whatsoever. I think there's a lot of room for for body part splits to evolve, even in the bodybuilding community. I think it's
the old school, even
the ones that and the ones that don't that see great results really understand programming.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. The bodybuilders that I met that were pros that you would see that I could see their body change show after show because you could just tell that they have this pro. Then you had other guys that kind of looked the same all the time.
Yeah.
Every show that their physiques weren't progressing.
Same sequence.
And I knew they were taking more and more drugs. So technically, if they're taking more drugs and they're
that was the one variable they changed, right?
That
they just added more.
That
drugs.
Was it. It was just it was that or more intensity and more cardio. I mean, those were the variables that they manipulated. And nobody really dives into the programming. So I'm just and of course this is a total overgeneralization that Sal and I are both saying, but I would venture to say that a lot of those guys. Would even benefit it from two.
Yeah, just increasing the frequency.
Both then. What would you think about two if you've always done split to change it up and just do, you know, a total body focused or vice versa, right?
Yeah, no,
if you always did total body workouts, you know, doing a split to kind of give you a different stimulus
as
well.
It's just the frequency thing because I did experiment not too long ago with hitting a body part once a week and sure enough, you just... You know, I like the pump I got, like the volume, but I didn't get good.
You know, that's the big thing that everyone hangs on to. It's the pump.
Yeah.
Especially in the bodybuilding community, it's all about the pump. Like everybody is chasing the pump. Like
you keep focusing on that one body part that you could just squeeze the
max. No doubt, you get the best pumps
on
a split.
Yeah. That's what they talk about. But I mean, that's just one factor in building muscle. It's not the only factor. And when you're so adapted to getting pumped all the time,
it's the addiction.
I would venture to say that the benefits that you got from it are a lot different than when you got the first pump a year ago. You know,
and there's techniques you can use to get a better pump anyway. You don't have to do a shit ton of volume. To you know, squeeze blood into a muscle and get a better pump. I remember when I first switched over to, because I didn't go from a straight split to full body. I went from a typical bro split, one body part a day, to a split where I paired up certain body parts and hit each body part twice a week. Then from there, I went to full body. And each time I did that, because I remember when I first switched over, it was like, let's see. It was years ago. I was getting ready to go to Italy to visit family, and I wanted to get really fit because my whole family there knows I'm in fitness, so I wanted to look really lean. So I started watching my nutrition, and I wanted to experiment with training more frequently. By the way, old-time bodybuilders always train more frequently, even as late as the 70s, you know, and 80s. Arnold Schwarzenegger hit a split, but he hit his body parts three times a week. So if you look at his old routines, it was three times a week. Mm-hmm. It was a double split routine is what he did, where he had two body parts in the morning and two at night or something like that, or one at night. And he still did a lot of frequency. So it's relatively recent where we did this whole one body part a day type of thing. But I switched over to this, and I'll never forget, I got more muscular and leaner than I'd ever gotten before. Now, one thing that I recognized when I switched was that's when I learned about going to failure. That's when I learned that I needed to maybe not go to failure as often because I couldn't because I was hitting it so frequently. And that's eventually later on what led me to understanding that not going to failure more often than not would benefit me. But I remember switching to the full body. And man, when I switched to full body routine, it was that week I got stronger. Like that week, I literally went 2-3 workouts, I'm lifting, and boom. All of a sudden stronger, all of a sudden feeling better. And if you've been working out and lifting weights for a long time
and you feel something,
you
like
know
that. Yeah, it's a big deal.
I know within I could do a workout and I'll know, oh wow, that's there's something to that right away. And that's how it was for full body for me, and I never looked back since. And everybody I've ever recommend do this that I know personally, like my cousin Gabriel, my cousin Alex, I've had my cousin Giuseppe do it, my brother, you know, my cousin Gabriel is a good example. Good genetics, builds decent amount of muscle.
And the reality is people just aren't doing enough frequency. If they were,
that's it.
If they were, you were
running. Bro, he gained 6 pounds in like 4 weeks.
If you were running a split where you're hitting every muscle three times a week, then you're, but I, in my experience, most people that set themselves, they set a plan out to do that, but then they end up having a day off or something happens to where they can't hit every single week like that, and the volume drops down. So once that, if you could just get the frequency up, I think that running a split could be just as beneficial too. So I don't think it's either or.
Next question is from Tristan A. Branch. Do you guys have any advice for someone who wants to start their career as a trainer with the ultimate goal of opening a gym?
There's only one business that has a fail rate that's worse than opening a restaurant, and that's opening a gym.
Is that true?
I don't know. I feel like it is. Boy, I'll tell you what.
Sal feels like it is. I feel like it is.
Yeah.
Like, that's a new.
When I have a feeling, I go with it. Yeah. It's a new spiritual side of me.
That's what the fortune teller told you.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. My experience with this is I've owned a gym. I've ran gyms. I know what the numbers look like. I know the business pretty well. I would consider myself a veteran of the gym business. And let me tell you, when a large company, first of all, like 24 Hour Fitness, with all of their money and marketing and resources,
$25 million a year,
would give themselves 2 years before a gym would start to break even. Okay, that's a club with fucking marketing power and brand name behind it. In fact, 24 Hour Fitness was not fond of doing a ground up gym. They didn't like doing building gyms from scratch. What their strategy was, which was an effective one, was to take over a gym that already had a base, because it's so hard to
drum up all that business.
It's hard both ways, but it's extremely hard when you start from scratch.
Right.
You know what I mean? Open a gym. Profitability wise, like, do the math. Like, you open up a 25,000 square foot facility, you're going to pay, I don't know what part of the country you'll be in, but anywhere between.
How many trainers do you guys know personally? I mean, I can probably count close. I'll say
like 10, maybe.
Oh, shit. I'm way like 50.
Oh.
Yeah, at least.
That went to own their own gym?
Yeah, that went to go do their own gym.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you
would say over 10. I don't.
Yeah, I'm probably around 10, but you know more because you manage training for
so
long.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, man, there's a lot. How many of them have been really successful? I can count on one hand the ones that are successful.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you say successful, do you mean doors still open or
profitable or just making it happen?
Yes. I don't know any that are making it really happen. I mean, the ones that I know that are successful, they're doing what they love. They pay their bills and they're
by no means like.
Yeah, they're not balling out of control. None of them are living in, you know, multi-million-dollar house. No one's killing it, right? I don't know anybody personally.
And they're always there.
Right.
Always there.
Yeah, so like I think.
You can't go anywhere.
I know a lot that have failed.
But here's what but the ones that do.
Now that we crushed this person's dream.
No. Yeah, I know. I think we just, it's more about being more honest with yourself. And because some people, if you are this person, I'm not this person. I'm not that, like, I have bigger ambitions for myself, right? But some people would rather be like that way. Have your own gym, only really responsible for yourself, for a couple trainers.
Be in the gym all day.
Yeah, be in the gym all day.
It's like the old bar owner.
Right, exactly. It's like that. Like, if it's, you're not driven by money very much, or you don't have certain financial goals where you want to be, and you're realistic with that, I think it's a fucking awesome thing to potentially have and do. Mm-hmm. But I know I made a promise to myself that we would never open up, or I would never open up a gym like the one we have here, until I had built a business that doesn't need to survive off of those doors being open, right? So we don't even use this facility for any sort of revenue. We don't make any revenue off of it whatsoever, and that's how I wanted it, when I think all of you are the same way too.
It would cost us more money to even try.
Do you think maybe even like going the franchise route would be a better strategy if you were to accumulate, you know, enough capital yourself and then invest in something you thought was going to take off versus starting your own from scratch?
I looked into it, and the success rate with franchises is always higher. It just is, because
it's a proven
and model. I know more guys that have been successful doing the small. Like, I know some guys that did the what was the automated gyms. I almost
Snap.
Did that like that, but it's not that one. Yeah, so one of the you know, did a couple of those.
Anytime Fitness.
Anytime.
A lot of those are popping up.
Yeah, Anytime Fitness. Orange Theories, of course.
Orange Theories.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
15 of those fuckers, man.
That's what I'm saying. Like, if you with the franchise, they give you a plan. They have, it's all systems are set up. Mm-hmm. It's organized. And then you have the brand, you know, name kind of pushing people in. But then you're stuck with, you don't have the flexibility as like you want. You can't pay, you know, you have to pay a fee.
If you think about it, it's the same. You know, like owning your own business and starting from scratch, you have even less flexibility.
And the reality is, like, if you have to get to gym 2, 3, and 4 before you start gym, because each one, a small box gym is not going to make you more than about $70,000 to $150,000 a year tops, right? So, and if you have more,
you're good,
right? That's if you're really good. You're very successful if you're hitting those numbers, right? Then, so it's going to take gyms 2 and 3 before you start getting into the quarter to $500,000. And the success rate from somebody taking 1 to 2 is
well. Here's the way I look at
fucking
it.
Fucking a motherfucker.
Here's the
dude.
Way I look yeah. at it. The cost that you the money you have to invest to get one open is substantial. That's number one. Now I know CrossFit's back in the day. You could open one up for like $20,000 in a warehouse, but those days are over. It's a lot more difficult nowadays. So even if you open a box like a CrossFit box, you're probably going to spend close to six figures just getting it open or more, right? $100,000 or more just to get the doors open. Now, you want to try a big box gym? You want to try and do a 20,000 square foot or 25,000 square foot gym on your own? You're going to spend $1 million getting it open, getting equipment, running it. You're going to need money to pay yourself and your staff while you're running it. And then the cost, the way the gym industry works, it's such a low cost, high volume business where you've got 35,000 square foot facilities that are equipped
right.
to the gills.
Yeah.
Swimming
shower,
pool, jacuzzi,
bathroom.
Shower, steam room, basketball court that are charging $20 a month.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, some cheaper.
And you got to compete with that. And that means you got to get thousands and thousands and thousands of members to pay you $20 a month so that you can meet your
$50,000 a month. Here's where I see it smart. Like, okay, so we just went down and we just visited with Bradley Martin. Like, this guy has got a, 2 million following on Instagram. I'm sure at least a few hundred thousand of those are from LA. So this guy opens a gym in LA and it's a badass gym and he probably spends probably a mil plus just building it all out. Yep. And, he's going to have enough traffic from his Instagram to at least pay the bills. But I guarantee you, we went down there and I saw the traffic in there. He's not even murdering out of there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know what a full gym looks like, and right. I can tell if it's how much it's cranking out just by the traffic at primetime hours.
It's a tough situation.
We were there during prime hours. You would be able to tell.
It's a tough situation because on the one hand, like if you're a trainer and you want to open a gym, you're probably really serious about working out, right? So you want to have a gym that really caters like fitness people. But here's the problem with fitness people. They're the worst customers because fitness people really don't care about much but whether or not you have equipment, and they're going to use the hell out of your gym.
The three C's.
And the gym industry's already identified this. They know this.
Cost, convenience, and cleanliness.
Yeah. And they've seen this. They've seen that fitness people aren't money makers, so fuck them. What we want is the people who are going to pay us and not show up type of deal. It's a tough business. Yeah. My advice to you is if you're becoming a trainer and you want to stay in the fitness industry, either
start evolving to the virtual world.
Virtual or become a good private trainer, which is easier than opening a gym and being successful, but not easy, still hard, or go work for a large fitness corporate or organization and move your way up the ladder there, and you can do pretty well.
Oh, I think that's the most sound advice is to really go through the process. If you have never done it before and like you do want to own a gym,
that's
or like
a good
that's
point.
Like you have to start from somebody that's a well-oiled machine that can actually model like the systems for you. Otherwise, you have no idea what the timing is, what the how to deal with volume that comes in all of a sudden, and
oh my God,
staffing.
Imagine someone opening a gym who'd never managed a successful gym for at least a few years.
Well,
that's a nightmare.
Yeah, it is. It's a monster. Who was it? Oh, it was Kalipa we were talking about. He has like 30-something, right? 30-something gyms.
He has a ton of CrossFit boxes.
Right, to make a couple mil. It's like, yeah. I mean, I think he had 35 or something like that.
It's a lot of management.
Yeah, and some overseas. I mean, that's so much work.
It is.
To make that. You can make that a lot of different ways in the fitness industry.
Well, I mean,
a lot easier than that.
We're podcasting now. There's new forms, there's new mediums out there that you could actually explore and actually reach, more people, more volume of people, get your message out and capture that and monetize it. So I think there's just a lot more opportunities we didn't have before going through that process where, the ultimate goal was the gym.
I always try and ask myself, 10 years from now, do I believe too, a lot of people, will they still be working out in gyms, or will it be cool to go outside more, or will we have some cool virtual reality inside your house that's so badass? Like, right.
Home gyms, I feel, are going to get even more elaborate.
Right?
Yeah. Especially when, I'll tell you when, you want to know when that'll explode? When self-driving cars become a big thing.
Because
everybody has a garage, and you don't need to park your car in a garage. What are you going to do with it?
Convert it to a gym.
That's a gym, man.
Right.
Hell yeah.
That's a perfect place to put.
Yeah. I don't know. So if I'm a trainer coming up in the business right now, I'm thinking a lot of things like that besides just.
There is a side to me that's like, If I didn't have kids and
it's
I was
the owning the bar,
rat,
it's the owning bar thing. Yeah. That's the perfect analogy.
I'd sleep in the gym.
Totally. If you want to just do it for that reason, go for it.
Right, because you're hearing all of us talk all this shit right now, but then don't be surprised if you see us in 3 to 5 years have a gym.
Yeah.
Right? And it's just, but it's all for fun. You know, yeah. we would not go into it like
to make money.
It would be going into it because like the bar, I want to see our friends and work out and it'd be a cool place all for Mind Pump people to come by. Like that's why we would do it.
Next question is from Michael Salzel. What is your opinion on getting girls as a motivation to work out and build a nice physique? Can extrinsic motivation be as good as intrinsic motivation?
So, you know, it's a good question because I know a lot of guys
girls for the girls
start working out for this particular reason. Is it going to motivate you to exercise? It will. Is that the right kind of motivation or long lasting motivation? No. I mean, what do you do once you get the girls then? You know, keep working out to keep them. Why is this such a big deal to you? What do you feel, you know, maybe you don't feel good about yourself. How about, you know, exercising, not worrying about getting girls, feeling the confidence you get from changing your physique.
I think getting the girls is just a byproduct. I think it always comes back down to, because I'm sure when I was 17, 19 years old, I probably thought that was my motivation, but it was really more about myself. It was really my own insecurity.
Building your confidence.
Yeah, because I mean, I remember being
a
kid.
And that's what girls are.
That's what attracts the girls.
Well, before I ever worked out, you know, it was sophomore, junior year. I dated very pretty girls in school. Like, I have crooked front teeth. Like, so I learned early on that wasn't like the answer. So I really think most of what drove me was just my own insecurities of feeling inadequate next to other men. Mm-hmm. You know, I was a skinny boy in comparison. Now that was what I felt being a, you know, late teen, early 20s was looking at other men that were 18, 19, 20. And I just was very small. I was small, I was skinny, and I didn't feel. So I think, sure, we all, and the macho thing would be talking about getting girls. But I think in reality, I was probably really comparing myself to other men. And that's really what drove the insecurity to lift.
Unless you're like really unhealthy. There's more effective ways of attracting girls' attention, I think, than working out, except for the fact that
it doesn't hurt.
It
doesn't hurt. And working out does one thing. And this is the reason why I think sometimes
do you know what's
out,
funny though?
They get girls is because it builds their confidence.
I was just going to say that. Because you'd be surprised, like half of it is not just the physique. It's that when everyone gets
confidence.
Yeah, when you get super ripped like that, you walk with your chest up, your head up.
Your posture's
like
good.
If you can learn to do all those things.
Eye level's good, all that stuff. They pick up on that.
The guy at the bar who's super jacked with a tight t-shirt but is kind of weird and not charismatic doesn't do very well with the girls. Just doesn't. In fact, I've heard girls make fun of that guy many, many, many times. So it's the confidence that really does it. And working out will do that. It can do that, right? Mm-hmm. It can also do the opposite, though. Give you this big inflated ego and make you act like an asshole or feel like an asshole.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. When it comes to your motivation for working out, at the end of the day, if it's extrinsic, you're always going to be focused on something outside of you.
I think
and at some point that could end.
I think you can be extrinsic. I think you can if you are looking at like aesthetic. Right, like looking at it for your physique, and if you looked at it like a piece of like art, like you're trying to build or sculpt something, there is definitely a part of me that felt this that I never felt it before until I competed, I never had this. I never looked in the mirror and went like, "Oh, I'm not, my chest isn't there." It wasn't until
why you make that voice?
I feel like that's what some boy would do if he's like all sad about not having a chest, right? So it would sound something like that.
That little fat down there.
You know, so I don't know. Well, then again, maybe not. Maybe I definitely went through my time of being insecure about my calves. I went through that for a while.
Didn't you say you were looking at the calf implants?
Yeah.
At some point?
Yeah. So
did you actually talk to somebody about that?
Yeah, I did. It was $3,500.
Per calf?
No, total back then.
Oh.
Yeah, that was like total back then. But it was like really new then too, so I was a little scared.
Oh, man.
I was scared to...
I'm so glad you didn't do that, dude. Yeah.
Right.
I wouldn't be able to hang out with you.
Yeah. They'd probably be like shifted a little bit, you know? So
that just shows you how insecure I was about, you know. But I think like when I competed, I'm 30 years old at this time, right, when I'm competing. So I have a total different outlook on my physique. And I think I had a very healthy relationship with it too. Like when I was building, I was not... when I would look at my physique in the mirror, I would really be be like, this is me applying all the science that I understand and know from all these years that I never have truly done to this level, and I could visually see it. This is fucking cool. And I got off on that. I thought that was, and I had a very, very objective like way of looking at it, where when I looked at my physique, it wasn't feeling inadequate or insecure. It was like, oh shit, wow. When I actually increased my volume, did this, did that, I could actually see my shoulders now are popping out more, right? So I think, I don't think there's anything.
Being a student of it, you know?
Yeah, right. Yeah, so I think that was healthy. I don't feel like that. I wasn't attached to that. I could let go of that.
No, but I mean, just the way that, I don't know. Look, I don't know who this person is who's asking the question.
But I'm just saying that's an example of where it could be okay and healthy, I could see, right?
Yeah. So, I tell you what.
And if you could be totally douchey about
First of all, working out is good for you. You move better. You're stronger. It helps boost your confidence. So do it because of those things. If it's about getting girls, work on your social skills. That will yield you way better results.
Yeah.
If go learn how to talk to girls, go learn how to, you know, improve your charisma.
Get some charisma.
Get rid of your fear. You know, there's an art to it or whatever.
You're self-deprecating.
That works well. What?
Oh, yeah. It's my move.
I thought you said self-defecating.
No, definitely not. Not that.
That doesn't work?
No.
That's your move.
That one actually repels. It's a repellent.
Next question is from Ringo the Flamingo. If you are hungry...
This is a good name.
That's a great name, man.
If you are hungry and have no other options except processed crappy food, what's better, not eating any food at all or eating processed crappy food?
Not eating at all.
Yeah, for easy.
Yeah.
So easy. Yeah. You know what's funny?
Throw that shit in the garbage.
You know why that's a good question, though?
It is a good question because I would have asked that question 5 years ago.
Exactly.
5 years ago, I would have ate, and that was, fuck, man, so I totally understand it. It is a great question.
Oh, I need proteins. Snicker bar has proteins.
There would be days where I was on my, you know, air quote unquote diet right now, and I'm driving home, and I'm under my protein intake for the day, and I'm like, I'm so tired, but I need to go home and just go to bed. I'm like, fuck, it's better I drive through McDonald's and get McDonald's than to not eat at all. Like, my thought process was, I needed to make sure I hit my macro targets every day, and that was more important than this consuming this shitty food that I don't even. So I understand this question 100%, and so yeah, no, you. I wish I understood it the way I understand it now. You would be way better off just not eating, and that even goes for somebody who is trying to build muscle. Like, if you're trying to build muscle, it still doesn't matter. Like, still, it would be more beneficial for you to pass on that. But obviously, if you started to string a bunch of days together.
Well, that's when calories really start to count.
Right.
Like, you know, like, oh, I haven't eaten in 10 days.
But if we're talking about a one-off?
Yeah, should I eat this crappy processed food or not? It's like, okay, you're starving. You should eat it. But no, for the most part, avoid it. It's funny because we'll go on these 4-day trips or 3-day trips where we're podcasting. And we're doing a lot of traveling. I mean, when we were in LA, Adam and I were doing 2 or 3 podcasts a day. But in between the podcasts, we were stuck in LA traffic for between 1 to 2.5 hours. So it took us 2.5 hours at one point to get from one podcast to another. And this entire time, we don't eat. Because what are your options? Like, we're on the road. We're about, you know, our options are terrible.
Right.
So unless we stop at a grocery store and really make an effort, but we didn't necessarily have the time to do that. We just, and it's funny because we'll bring Taylor with us or Drew with us, and they're always like, man,
he's so mad.
You guys never fucking eat, man. I'm so hungry.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it's because unless we're going to eat something good, it's really not worth the effort to get those kind of foods, because then you're just going to feel terrible. It's not going to affect your body in a positive way. And we've talked about numerous times on this podcast the benefits of intermittent fasting. And so these are great opportunities to do that. And I wish I knew this when I was training people years ago, because when I would have clients, one of the challenges clients would have would be, you know, hey, when I'm in meetings all day, what do I eat? Or what do I eat when I'm traveling? And then I would...
You try to give them like a plan of like, carry these in your purse, or, you know, like some kind of like shitty snack that we're trying to substitute it with.
And I'd be like, take beef jerky and nuts with you and then eat that. And they're like, well, I'm at a meeting. They have food. I'm going to eat beef jerky and nuts.
Yeah.
Now I tell them...
Doesn't make sense.
Yeah, now I tell them that's a great day to fast. Like if you're not going to be home till 4... Do that day where you don't eat until 4, fast until then eat something that's good for you, and it's going to benefit you way more. And, you know, fasting, Adam talked about building muscle and fasting, and I know people are like, fasting is the opposite of what you should do to build muscle. Not necessarily. I don't think you should fast regularly if you're trying to build muscle.
And that's what I meant by that, right? That's where I was saying, like, if you did this on a regular basis, obviously it would not be a good idea. If it's not pro muscle by, you know, fasting every other day. That would not be a smart move. But intermittently, 100% you're better off.
No, I think it makes you more, your body more sensitive to proteins and carbohydrates and fats. I think it primes your body for, you know, better health and faster results. It increases insulin sensitivity, which is also important for building muscle. You know, if you have poor response to insulin, you're not going to shuttle glycogen and amino acids into muscle like you normally would. So I even recommend to people trying to mass build or whatever that, you know, once a week or maybe even once every other week, they do a kind of a longer fast where their first meal isn't till 3 p.m. or 4 p.m. or sometimes longer depending on the individual. And so far, people have been trying it and they've been coming back to me and being like, I'm building more lean body mass. I didn't get as fat doing it this way when I'm bulking. I feel better. I'm stronger and I have less gut issues, which, I mean, those are all pluses, you know, if you ask me. So check it out. If you go to the app store, you can get the Mind Pump app. The Mind Pump app lets you listen to our podcast and also has a search function so you can look up like a phrase or something and see all the episodes where we mention that particular topic. More to come as well in the app. It's currently free.
We are top podcast in our app.
Just go download the Mind Pump app. Yeah,
number one.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.